That's your recording now.
Thank you.
Right, thanks, Leona. Obviously, from the start of the meeting, before we begin today, can I remind you that the meeting is being recorded and the copy of the recording will be made available for public viewing on the Council's YouTube channel. That's the first thing. The next one is report of apologies for absence.
Yes, we have apologies from Councillor Swift, Chair.
Thank you. Any declarations of interest?
No.
Before I start the Chair's report, can I introduce the officers? The Council officers that are here today are Margaret McCrossan, Linda Hutchison, Fiona Muir for internal audit, and also representing Michelle Blair. Also, we have Anthony Jenkins, Kath McCormick, Alison Ballingall, and Jill Derbyshire. And from external audit, John Cornett, Louisa Yule, and for our first meeting, Emma Rose Drummond, although I did see your name as Emma Rose Mackey. So maybe you've got several names, I don't know. But welcome to you all, and a special welcome to Emma Rose. Thank you. Now we can move on to the Chair's report. My only comment today is to confirm, as agreed at the most recent Council meeting, that the meeting of the committee that was due to take place on the 18th of November has now been rescheduled to the 25th of November. This is with a view to the annual accounts and all other items are scheduled to be considered that month being discussed at a single meeting. The accounts will be formally submitted to the Council after that, and the arrangements for that meeting will be confirmed to you in due course. Now we can move on to the main body of the meeting, and item four is the withdrawal from the European Union, and it's Anthony, it's you're on the floor for this one. You're
good afternoon.
Right, that's fine.
Thank you very much for having me this afternoon. By way of kind of covering the report, I don't have a huge amount to add. I would say there's probably two changes that we can qualify as EU exit related that are highlighted in the report. One would be the end of the EU settlement scheme at the end of June. I believe the Home Office are due to publish figures potentially this week, but next week probably is more likely, on local authority breakdowns of the EU settlement scheme to the end of June. There are still avenues for later applications. We've got some information up on the Council website, and we would support anyone making late applications where we can. It does appear to be the discretion of the Home Office on what kind of conditions a late application would be accepted. And I suppose until that's tested, we wouldn't really know how far that would go. The other kind of key change is definitely EU exit related is related to data equivalency. And it's not so much a change as much as a confirmation of the status quo. So the UK was awarded equivalency rating for data and information sharing, which just means that prior to EU exit, we can continue to data share with European nations as we did before EU exit was a buzzword or a byword. The other thing that we have seen but can't equivocally rule it as EU exit related, given the kind of makeup of what's happened, is price increases and scarcity of products across a number of sectors. So primarily construction has been heavily impacted. We've seen kind of staff impacts in terms of HGV drivers nationally and a number of other fields. What I would say is EU exit is probably a factor in that, but we can't put it as the sole factor or in some cases the only factor. Sorry, that's the same thing. We can't put it as the only factor. In some cases it might not even be the factor. So there are elements such as the kind of Suez Canal crisis earlier on this year. Obviously COVID and isolating is impacting workforces. So some of the issues like timber is a global shortage. The energy price hikes we are seeing as a kind of global thing. But I believe Brexit is probably a contributing factor to some things, particularly when we have a different border model from what we've had previously, and businesses need to adapt to it. But I don't have anything further to add to the report than that. It's really just if there's any questions or anything I can clarify further.
Thanks, Anthony. I know I read your report, and between the pandemic, Brexit and the Suez, there's so many things that are muddying the water, shall we say. Annette, your hand is up first.
Thanks, Chair. Anthony, thanks for the report.
I'm going to apologise. I've got several questions to ask you. If you can. So I thought I better preface that with there are a few. If you can, give me the information just now, even if you could point me in the direction of who could, or if you could come back to me at a later point, because this report, I've been concerned with them as they've been coming to the committee, but I'm now at the point where I'm really concerned with what I'm hearing. So I'm going to just run through my questions. I'll just get them up in front of me. On paragraph 5, and I think you have sort of slightly touched on this, it says there's obviously significant work still needed to identify specific Brexit pressures. Do you have an indication of when we might be able to have a further report detailing these differences and when we can extrapolate one from the other? I'll just run through them if that's okay, Anthony. Paragraph 8 states that businesses face increased import-export difficulties because of the changed border regime, as well as challenging supply chain environment. Import-export faces duty costs as well as indirect costs arising from paperwork and goods checks. It goes on to discuss the expiry of the grace period on the 1st of October. So my question really from that is, can you give me an idea of what will happen once these grace periods expire? And I think that's probably the gist of most of my questions, is looking for a wee bit more information on these. Paragraph 9, across that, the paper says that across the council there have been impacts in relation to the pricing and availability of construction, road and environmental raw products. You did comment on that just there in the introduction, that these products are subject to significant price increases. How is this affecting our programme of works and even our upcoming winter maintenance programme? That's the one that worries me just now. I know we had a paper that came to the full council that was about COVID recovery, and it was a great paper and it had a lot of information on it, but it did mention that there were concerns about the winter maintenance programme. So how is that in paragraph 9? Is that impacting that or our programme of works as we move forward? I'll keep going. Paragraph 11 states that the price increases and product scarcity has affected our food purchasing. And this was one I didn't expect when it came up. But it says, for example, poultry prices for school meals have increased by 27%. Question from this, from paragraph 11, is when we will have a better idea of costs associated with these increases, because that seems quite a lot, especially the school food prices. And I see that our procurement purchase times are affecting our vehicle purchasing as well. Again, how will this affect the individual services? So I can see that there are things that are listed, but again, I'm just wanting to know, how does this affect us? And also, I do apologise, Anthony, with regard to the funding that's being provided, I think that's paragraph 18 to 20 covers that. It talks about what that there might be funding which is available to the council, which we would welcome any funding that comes our way. I saw that, I'm just having a wee look to see what my question was in that. It's not clear right now how this is going to be apportioned across the UK or how much will be allocated to Scotland. Do you know when we'll have more information and what will be available? Not even so much to Scotland, but when will we know what will be available to East Renfrewshire Council? Quite keen to find that out. I'm getting there. Paragraph 28 covers the EU settlement scheme, which you were talking about just there as well. And I know I bring this up every single time these papers are brought up. I'm concerned, and actually maybe you can correct me if I don't need to be concerned, but I'm concerned right now that I'm seeing only 63% have applied to the settlement scheme here locally. What happens to the other 37%? And do we have any dates on when we might have an idea on that as well? And my very final point was that given the everything that's been identified in the paper and everything else that we know is happening around us just now, how is our money advice and rights team and our local citizens advice service prepared I'm a wee bit, I want to make sure that we are prepared to deal with what might be quite a large increased demand on the service. So is it something we're aware of and are we preparing for it? So that's my questions. Apologies again. I know it's a lot, but I wanted to try and get everything down.
I dare say a yes, no answer will not suffice.
It is just a lot more information on a lot of these points. Thanks, Anthony.
Yeah, no problem. Certainly the ones I can answer just now would probably be in relation to the funding. Unfortunately, we won't know individual amounts that East Drumshire is entitled to or would get until we submit a funding application based on my current understanding of the schemes. So the way it looks like it's going to work is it would be a competitive bidding process for the UK Shared Prosperity Fund, and every local area would, a local authority or even certain kind of cross authority groups could apply for that funding, and it would be on a case-by-case basis. It is expected in the kind of autumn statement there'll be more detail from the UK government on that, but we wouldn't be able to give clarity on figures. And I suppose in relation to your question on the import controls, what would be expected for import going forward is if it's a product of animal origin, it would need an export health certificate signed by a competent vet and various checks in relation to that. So at UK border, they would have to check that that's in place, that the descriptions on the various customs forms they have to fill out for import match up with the product and collect duty. I can get more detail on that though, but that would be the kind of basics of what would be sought at the border depending on the type of product, safety certificates and all that kind of thing. Everything else I would probably have to get back to you on, but I'll do that as a
thank you. It is appreciated, and I knew I was throwing a lot that you might not be able to report to the meeting right now, but if any of it can be looked into, Julia, I would really appreciate it with the chair's agreement.
Margaret, I see your hand up there. Would you like to comment?
Yeah, I'll do my best to tick a few off Anthony's list that he has to go away and pick up later. The impact on the capital programme and winter maintenance. The capital programme, if we've got any specific contracts that are underway or almost completed, then we should be all right if inflation has been locked out, if you like, by having locked in on the contract price. Where we're more at risk is where we are about to enter into contracts where we haven't yet got tender prices nailed down. And we've got a couple of big schemes coming up. The largest two are the Neilson campus and the new leisure centre. We've not been out to tender for those, and when we go out to tender, we should get an indication of whether the prices have been pushed up because the bidders are seeking to mitigate any risks that they think there might be through either inflation or shortages. In the next month or two, we should begin out to tender for the Neilson campus, so we should get an indication there. And of course, once we do know what the total costs of a capital project are going to be, we don't start paying for it immediately. We spread the cost over the life of the asset through loan charge repayments. So we effectively borrow and make these payments back through the revenue budget. And we might have to borrow, obviously, if the price of the project is up, we have to borrow a bit more. And over the life of the project, we then start paying back more. But that means that we have to start the project and then start making the repayments before we feel the impact. So for capital repayments, it'll be more than a year off for any new projects that come in at a higher price. Winter maintenance, as far as grit supplies are concerned, If those are in demand, if they're going to be short, we would continue to go through Scotland Excel and purchase as much as we can in bulk or through group arrangements to try to mitigate any risk there. When will we know about the food price increases? Well, a lot of work is being done with Scotland Excel to renegotiate contracts and engage with new suppliers to try to get the best possible deal. So they are working with that. At the moment, the Education Department are working on what they think their cost pressures for next year will be so that they can feed them into the budget process. That's really an exercise that will come to a head in about the next month. But if there are any further developments after that, of course, we can keep adjusting our budget plans right up until we set our budget in February next year. The impact on vehicle costs, some of our vehicles for the council are very specialised and obviously very expensive. It's true that a lot of the component parts for those are either going up in price or are in very short supply. And strangely enough, some of those are semiconductors because so much in vehicles is electronic and computerised these days. However, we have to order our vehicles very far in advance. There's lead-in times for some of these specialist vehicles that are a year or more. So again, we usually have quite a lot of time to plan that and to then factor in the impact onto our capital plans and after that, even further in the future, into the loan charge repayments. And I think that was about all of the ones that I could help out on. I'll leave the rest to Anthony.
Thank you so much, Margaret. That's really helpful.
Barbara, you've got a question.
Well, it's not so much a question, Chairman. I just kind of have the feeling that the business that we have got to deal with as far as the EU is concerned, they try to be as obstructive as they possibly can rather than helpful in any way. So it really wasn't so much a question because I appreciate Anthony's probably got more than enough to think about. But I think that the EU are not helpful. They've got a policy of not being helpful. And the fact that we've to deal with the virus as well is just a good excuse for being unhelpful. That was all, Chairman.
Thank you, Barbara, for your comments. As far as the food purchasing is concerned, I would, as a local farmer, I would recommend that you the council's reduce food miles and buy local food. However, that's maybe a personal point of view. Any further questions on this to Anthony? Sharon, I see your hand up.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. I was just going to come in response to Councillor Ireland's question about money advice and rights as well. So obviously you'd ask the question about money advice and rights, I guess, up to speed and expecting the demand. At this point in time, obviously we are seeing increases in fuel and food costs and we're not sure where that will go. And also furlough schemes came to an end, are coming to the end at the end of this month. So we are expecting an upsurge in the number of contacts that we will get through our money advice and rights team. And we do plan to continue to monitor that and advise as appropriate. So at this point in time, we are, you know, the team are managing the demand and we are going to continue to monitor because we do expect, obviously, normally that team see a peak around about January after Christmas time. So we expect we might start seeing that demand increase earlier than what we normally would.
Thanks, Sharon. It's just that one is a worry for me. So it's great that you're keeping an eye on that. Thank you. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Sharon, Margaret. Anyone else like to have a go at Anthony? Obviously, Anthony, you've explained things well enough. Linda, you're in mute.
May I just check what you want to do going forward? Are you wanting, the report does ask if you want to seek a further report?
Yeah.
And it was just to get some clarification on that.
Do the committee want a further report on this? things are moving on at a pace. So do we want another report from Anthony or not?
Should we have one, Chairman, before the May elections? Should we have one before then?
Well, Annette, would I see your hand up there?
No, just because of the number of questions that I got as I read through it, I would really welcome an updated report. More information on the better.
We did have a chat about this earlier on. Jim, I heard you. A chat about this earlier on, and we kind of thought it might be a good idea to have another update, maybe March time. I think that's rather than going into April when it's maybe a few weeks before the election and folk come out and start electioneering in this committee. I just don't want that. Yeah. So to kind of sometime at the end of February, March time, something like that.
Okay,
Linda.
Thank you.
Right, we'll move on now to the annual report on managing absence. Kath, it's your turn this time.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. I'll just take you through the sickness report. So this report covers the year, so the sickness year, the 1st of April 2020 through to the 31st of March 2021. So you'll note in the report that there has been an overall sickness absence improvement across both the local government employees and the teachers since the previous reporting year. There's been a reduction in local government employee absence at 10.4 days lost per FTE compared to 13 days lost the previous year. So that's a 2.6 day decrease. In terms of teachers, it's reduced to 4 days FTE is full-time equivalent compared to 5.2 days the previous year. So again, a reduction there, and that's of 1.1 days. Overall, the council's annual days absence per full-time equivalent employee was 8.2 days, which is an improvement in both the previous years where it was 10.1 days. In terms of COVID absence, the council has actually moved to recording long COVID absences of over 4 weeks from the 27th of May this year. So you will see these COVID absences included in the future report, but they're not included in the report for this year. So I'll just give you a very quick summary in terms of the top absence reasons. So these are in 2021, there was stress, non-work related, musculoskeletal, which includes back pain and gastrointestinal disorders. And these are the same three reasons really year in, year out. Last year, we told you about we were going to introduce a financial wellbeing provider, and that's actually something that we've done this year. And in terms of financial wellbeing, it's been highlighted through sickness absence best practice that anything to do with really finances can really attributed to stress, non-work related, which is obviously our main absence reason. So we're hoping that by putting in place a financial wellbeing provider, it will help our staff to monitor their spending, evaluate their own financial wellbeing. So we'll be monitoring this quite closely. And we've continued as a council to benchmark our approaches against leading HR expert organisations and other local government organisations as well, to make sure that we are promoting health and wellbeing support to our staff, and making sure that the provision of sickness absence support is there for staff, and also that managers are also taking part in this as well. So I don't know if anybody has any questions on that report. I appreciate it was quite long.
Chairman, could I just mention? Yeah, I mean the business of benchmarking. We benchmark with other councils, and I'm not sure that gives us a reading that's really helpful, to be truthful with you, because you're just benchmarking exactly the same as we do. Do you know what I mean? I think if you were able to benchmark with things outside councils, you might get a better reading, because to me, just benchmarking with other councils is fairly irrelevant, because they're going to say exactly the same things that we're saying. I don't really find that helpful at all, to be truthful with you.
Because you're right, we do benchmark our sickness absence PI, so that's the data, the number of days that are off. But what we try to do is benchmark best practice as well. So we do use the Chartered Institute of Personnel Development that help with kind of, I suppose, solutions. So like the putting in place the financial well-being, not all councils have done that, but that's something that from reading kind of, you know, journals, that's been suggested as a way of supporting like employees with stress non-work related. But I understand what you're saying in terms of benchmarking number of days. It doesn't always give you a, I suppose, the best solution of how to manage absence.
How can we manage that? How can we improve it?
I mean, in terms of HR, we do work quite closely with other councils and other HR departments, and we do have quite a good network. And I guess, I suppose it's just trying to open ourselves up to other networks like the private sector and other sectors to see what they're doing in terms of sickness absence management. And that's really where the Chartered Institute of Personnel and Development helps. As I say, they run numerous surveys, they write a report on an annual basis, and we do look for kind of guidance from them as well.
Jim.
Thank you, Chair. Yeah, due to the fact that obviously a lot of people have been working from home, has there been any evidence that where they wouldn't have come into the office, they've actually went to work and not feeling 100% because they've been working at home? Has there any been evidence gathered on that?
Not as such, because we do still expect that where somebody's unable to work, that they should still be logging that as sickness. But I guess that could be, I mean, something that we probably have seen a reduction in is kind of the common cold where people may have had that previously. So I think really when we get the data from next year, we'll probably be able to pull some of that out, probably in the report. But okay. I do understand what you're saying, because you're right, when you're working at home, it's probably easier to just get on with work rather than drag yourself into the office when you're not feeling so good.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, any further questions? I don't see any hands up. Jim, your hand's still up, but I take it that's right, that's fine, thanks. So with no further questions, I think we'd move on to the next one, which again is Kath, is the summary of Ellis Town redundancy costs to the end of March 2021.
So I'll just provide you with this report. So just to specify, these are the pre-audit early retirement redundancy costs. So this is between the year the 1st of April 2020 and the 31st of March 2021. So there has been a reduction, which I'm sure you'll have noticed from the previous year. And in terms of the report, what I've done is actually merged the data, so it's just in one line rather than previously we would have broken it down by services. So there were five instances of early retirement redundancy last year. Now, two of these instances were due to the end of temporary contracts, with the individuals actually being legally entitled to a redundancy payment as their contract exceeded 2 years. Now, this is the first year we've actually highlighted this, and we discussed this at the committee last year, and that was asked to be included in future years. Mm. In terms of the pre-audit costs of processing the early retirements and redundancies, this was 124,000, resulting in a net annual saving of 140k. So from these figures, the initial outlay of processing the early retirements or redundancies will be recovered in under a year, so 0.9 years, with savings year on year of 139k. Mm-hmm. That's really the main summary of the report. I don't know if there's any questions.
There's certainly no hands up as yet.
No.
But it'd be very difficult to ask questions without identifying folks, so I'm not encouraging that. So there's no hands up, so we will move on to the next one. It's the National Fraud Initiative, and I believe Alison's the speaker for this one. The floor is all yours.
Thank you, good afternoon, everyone. The National Fraud Initiative, or NFI, in Scotland is a counter-fraud exercise led by, led by Audit Scotland and overseen by the Cabinet Office for the UK as a whole. It uses computerised techniques to compare information about individuals held by different public bodies and on different financial systems that might suggest the existence of fraud or error. It means that public bodies can take action if any fraud or error has taken place, and it allows auditors to assess fraud prevention arrangements which these bodies have. In East Renfrewshire Council, we have a single point of contact for NFI, and that sits within my team. They coordinate the data returns and ensure that results are circulated to services for action. To make the most of NFI, we should be investigating data matches, identifying fraud and errors and stopping them, recovering any overpayments and improving systems as a result. Within the report, there's a table at paragraph 10, and that shows the breakdown of the results from the most recent exercise. It shows that there are over 3,000 matches that were flagged to us through NFI. This is a reduction of around 1,000 on the previous exercise, and that's mainly due to the implementation of the new Integra Finance and Procurement System, which is leading to a more robust control environment. To date, recovery action has netted in the region of £77,000, and that's been due to the cancellation of single-person discounts. The report today gives a broad overview of the NFI process and outcomes, and it confirms that ERC have a robust and effective approach to NFI. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Alison. Appreciate your report. Anyone would like to either comment or question?
Chairman, can I just a quick comment? In the table that we've got here, council tax reduction, that's like single person reduction. Is that what we're looking at in that table one on page 20? Page 20. Council, is that for a single person? And these numbers that you've given us,
I'll maybe just give you the difference between, so council tax reduction is different from the single person discount. They're separate things. So the first one that you see there, council tax reduction, where there's 349 items. So that's somebody who gets a reduction in their council tax for specific reasons, income related. Whereas the single person discount is slightly different from that. That's where you've got only one individual living in a home. And so that would entitle somebody to a single person discount. They're both within that realm, but slightly different reasons for a discount.
I understand that now. Okay, thank you.
Great, thanks very much. Looking at the figures there, 31% single person discount, does that mean 31% of our households is single people?
That's correct, yes.
It does seem quite a large amount.
Yes, that's and I think it's expected to increase over time in terms of the statistics that we have and the data forecasts. Show that we expect single households to increase over time. So yes, that's how we're at the moment.
Well, everyone's their own. Any further questions or comments? No, we'll move on to the next item, and the managing the risk of fraud and corruption, the fraud response statement. And I believe it's Jill Darwisher who's speaking to this one. Thank you, Jill.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much. In order to demonstrate compliance with the Code of Corporate Governance, this fraud response statement provides an overview of the measures in place across East Renfrewshire Council to address anti-fraud, bribery and theft, managing the risk of fraud and corruption, and to provide updates on actions undertaken during 2020-21 where appropriate. In addition, this year, this report includes the Council's response to the Fraud and Irregularities 2020-21 report produced by Audit Scotland. A copy of the report, which was published in July this year, was previously circulated to all committee members. As you'll see in the report, a wide range of measures are in place to address and prevent fraud, bribery and theft, involving many services and areas across the council. These measures are set out within the report under a broad range of headings, such as governance, ICT and cybercrime, procurement, health and wellbeing, and payment, insurance, payroll and HR. As mentioned specifically in the Audit Scotland report, as a way to reduce counter-fraud risks, East Renfrewshire Council has an effective approach to the National Fraud Initiative, as you've just heard outlined and detailed by the Senior Revenues Manager in the previous item. The Audit and Scrutiny Committee provide a scrutiny role in this area, and investigations are normally undertaken by the internal audit team. And during 2020-21, only one potential fraud incident was reported to the committee. It's asked that the Audit and Scrutiny Committee note the content of the fraud response statement and the work being undertaken across the Council in relation to this area and the reporting already in place, and also considers the feedback provided in the context of the comments made in the Audit Scotland report. Happy to take any further comments or provide answer any questions if I can. Thank you.
You must have done it very well, because I don't see any hands up at all. And I keep looking around the screen and there's nothing at all. Okay, well, we can consider all these things and note the contents, and there's no feedback whatsoever. So we'll move on to the next item, the review of strategic risk register and risk management progress. And Jill, it's you once again.
Thank you very much. So this report provides the latest biannual update of the Council's strategic risk register. The previous update was considered by the Audit and Scrutiny Committee in the 18th of March 2021. The strategic risk register sets out our key strategic risks to be considered by the Council and details the actions put in place to mitigate these and manage the risk. A thorough review of all risks on the register has been undertaken by the corporate management team. Appendix 1 of the report set out the current strategic risk register. In detail, the key amendments and updates since this document was last reported are that 13 risks remain as a high, 3 risks have been rescored from high to medium, 3 risks were rescored from medium to high, 3 risks were added to the register, 3 risks were removed from the register, and 5 risks retain the same score as previously when you consider the report, but the risk descriptions have been amended to reflect the current position or provide further clarity. The risk map on page 38 of your papers shows the spread of risks, and the table below that shows the risk count by strategic outcome. The corporate management team continues to discuss and review the strategic risk register on a regular basis, and it remains a standing item on the weekly corporate management team agenda. In summary, there are currently 42 risks, of which 18 are evaluated as high. The Audit and Scrutiny Committee is asked to consider and note the development of this Council Strategic Risk Register, noting that this is indeed a live document and will be updated and amended by the CMT as appropriate. Happy to provide any further details if requested. Thank you.
Thanks, Joe. Barbara's got a question this time.
Well, I'm not sure it's a question. Clarification, maybe. Page 37. The risk of failure of a key care provider. I understand that, fair enough, but I don't see how we are in a position to pick up the slack, if you know what I mean. It's not us that's providing it, somebody else is providing it. Do you know what I mean? It's quite difficult for us to say, this is a big risk for us. Well, of course it is. Anything that we get from an outside provider, if they went belly up, obviously it would be a risk for us. But I'm not quite sure how do we mitigate all of that. If we're not in charge of it, somebody else is in charge of it, and we're getting their facility. How do we deal with that? Sorry, I know it sounds a bit vague, but I think you probably get what I'm at.
Margaret?
Unfortunately, we have had experience of this just in the last few years. One of our local providers did indeed close down, and unfortunately, there's no one here from IGIB, but I'm sure Julie Murray could explain to you the trauma that they went through trying to make sure that the duty of care to all these fragile residents was continued. And although the establishment itself closed down, someone had to step in to make sure that we could find suitable care at very short notice for all of the people affected and keep all their families updated on what was happening and deal with any concerns. So there was a lot of joint working went on between the IGIB, the social work department, and the local health board. And I'm sure Julie Murray could provide a bit more detail. And you're right, it's not necessarily an ongoing service issue for us, but in the transition, it can be quite a sharp workload for the care staff and the IGIB.
I appreciate all of that, Margaret, and I understand all of that. But at the same time, you know, we've got a risk register. You know, there are so many things you could put on that risk register that we're actually not responsible for. And that's what I'm getting at. You know, it's a trauma for anybody who's having to put somebody into a home and then the home goes, as I say, out of commission and we're left to deal with it. All I'm saying is that putting these things on the risk register is all very well, but there's hundreds of things we could put on a risk register that we are not directly responsible for, but we've still got to pick up the pieces afterwards. So I'm not making myself very plain, but I understand.
That's half the reason, Barbara, is that, yes, like so go back to the care home scenario, yes, it's not up to us to keep the care home going, but it's up to us to pick up the pieces for the vulnerable residents that have to be moved. And that's where our risk comes in. So that I think it's quite right that this risk is on our risk register. And it doesn't matter whether it's somebody else, whether it's vulnerable children or whatever. It's up to us to fill in the blank, shall we say.
It's quite difficult when you put these things onto a risk register that the nuances of the whole thing are can be difficult for folk to get handle on. That's it. Okay, that's all.
I take on board what you're saying, and I think you probably hit the nail on the head there. The trick, as Jill will know, is in the phrasing the risk very precisely. The risk to the council isn't that we have to provide the care on an ongoing basis for these people. We don't have to take them all to Bonnet and House, but we do have to make sure that they have appropriate care put in place for them by another means, and that's probably slightly different. We can always look at the precise wording of that risk to maybe draw out and make it a wee bit clearer.
Good.
Okay, everyone quite happy with that now, or can live with that? Okay, thanks, Jill. Appreciate it. Now we move on to the local external audit report. Now, as Barbara said earlier on, we've really got the big guns here. We've got John and Louisa and Emma Rose from external audit. I take it will be John that's speaking to it.
No, I wasn't going to. Louise is going to pick it up.
Okay, thanks, Louisa.
Our management letter outlines a review of internal controls within the council's financial statement systems for the financial year 2020-21. Paragraph 4 outlines the coverage of our work, and paragraphs 5-8 outline our key findings. We note that the council implemented a new HR payroll system and benefits and council tax system in the year. Both systems were introduced partway through the year, and our review and testing of the systems covered the full financial year, so we tested in both the old and the new system. Appendix 1 outlines our key findings and action plan, and management have responded to all the points. There are a number of points that relate to the new systems where a number of controls were not fully implemented or operational between December 2020 and March 2021. We have undertaken additional audit work and substantive testing in a number of areas to gain the necessary assurances for our financial statements work. I don't plan to go through each point in detail, but I'm happy to answer specific questions or go into further detail.
Thanks, Louisa. Does anyone like to comment or ask any questions?
No.
Nobody at all. Margaret? I thought you would pick up somewhere along the line.
Just to say that you'll see from the appendix there that we passed those comments round all the departments. And the management response column has come back from the various heads of service involved, particularly those overseeing the new systems, because that's where most of the findings not surprisingly, are being raised at the moment, as you'd expect. And in each case, we have managed to come up with either explanations or proposed actions to remedy any shortcomings. And the right-hand column is just pointing out, for an audit trail purpose, who will be taking action and when we would expect that to be done, so that it can be picked up and checked on and as we go forward.
Thanks very much. Any further comments? I take you no one to comment, John.
I wasn't going to say anything in particular, Chair. The only thing I was going to say, just to finish off with, is clearly we'll follow up on all of the action points as part of next year's audit. And what we'll probably do is frame a risk in next year's audit plan that's linked to following up those recommendations and those action points, so that you'll see the closing of the loop on that next year.
Thank you very much. Any further points at all? Nothing at all. Okay, we go to the last item on the agenda, is the internal audit annual report, which is usually Michelle, but in Michelle's place, who's obviously sunning herself somewhere, we have Fiona Muir.
Welcome. Hi, thank you for that. So as you know, Michelle's an annual leave this week, so she's asked me to present the internal audit annual report. The primary function of internal audit is to provide an assurance statement to the Council on governance, risk management and internal controls. This duty is formalised in financial regulations, as is the requirement to produce an annual report which details the activities of the section during the year. 2021 was a very challenging year for internal audit for a number of reasons, and the audit plan was substantially reduced on two occasions. There were lower staff levels due to an internal secondment and long-term illness, and wider COVID restrictions impacted on the ability to carry out audits. However, despite this, sufficient audits were completed to enable an annual opinion to be given. 14 reports were issued relating to the 2021 audit plan, and satisfactory responses have been received for all of these. There are also two audits where the work has been completed, but reports have not yet been issued. The original 2021 plan provided 733 direct audit days, but this was revised downwards on two occasions and approved by committee to 349 days. All audit work relating to the revised plan was carried out, though, as previously mentioned, two reports are still to be issued. Throughout the year, detail has been provided in progress reports of high and medium risk recommendations. There were two reports which totaled four recommendations which were not fully accepted by management, but all responses were classified as acceptable. Since three of the four recommendations were in a follow-up report, members of the committee have already been provided with full details. The remaining recommendation not accepted was within the creditor payments report, and detail of this is provided at paragraph 3.5 in the main report. This related to advanced certification by procurement of all orders exceeding the amounts specified in the Council's standing orders. For contingency, there was an available budget of 97 days and 56 of these days were used. Contingency is a very difficult area to budget for, as it can be used for a number of purposes, such as freedom of information requests, certification of grants which were not known about at the time of audit planning, and investigation of anomalies or queries which arise during the year, or general requests for assistance from departments. In relation to general contingency, six matters were covered, and none of these related to a loss to the Council. Only two matters were dealt with using fraud contingency this year, and only one of these involved a loss to the Council. And as this matter is still being investigated by Police Scotland, we cannot say anything further about this at this time. In terms of public sector internal audit standards, the internal audit section complies with this, and this is specifically noted at section 5. A copy of the PSIAS Quality Assurance Improvement Plan has to be included within the annual report, and this is at Appendix C. As already noted, when the PSIAS self-assessment was presented to committee in August, there is limited scope to make improvements, as we are already 95% fully compliant, and partially compliant in a further 4% of the standards. Some performance indicators have been reported to Audit Committee on a quarterly basis, and for others, it is only appropriate to report these on an annual basis. A summary of all the indicators is given with the targets and actual achievement for the year. 5 targets were not met, and some reasons for this are given in the report at paragraph 6.2, and is primarily due to access issues, new systems, slow responses from departments, and reduction in the staffing level. The annual assurance statement can provide only reasonable and not absolute assurance against loss, and is based on a number of sources of evidence, such as work done by both internal and external audit, inspection agency reports, and annual assurances from each director. The assurance statement is made subject to all of these recommendations being implemented by management. Prime responsibility rests with management to put in place appropriate and sound systems of internal control. My conclusion is that reasonable assurance can be placed on the adequacy and effectiveness of the Council's framework of governance, risk management, and internal control, except for the area still under investigation by Police Scotland. In conclusion, there is clear management commitment in most departments to work with audit to improve existing procedures. This is monitored through our ongoing follow-up programme. As noted in the past, there is a very good working relationship between internal and external audit, with external audit continuing to place reliance on the work carried out by internal audit and joint working wherever possible to avoid duplication of testing. I would ask that the committee note the contents of the annual report and approve the annual assurance statement and submit it to the council. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Fiona. Annette.
Thanks, Chair. Thanks for that, Fiona. It was just one question. I'm just getting that up. It was paragraph 3.5 in the report on the high risk recommendation. Management should ensure that processes are in place to enable them demonstrate that all purchases over 50,000 and above have been certified by procurement. I noticed that the report states there's currently no way to ensure advanced certification, because the original order started out under 50,000, but then it ultimately goes over, and there were 28 instances of this. Mm-hmm. So my question is, are you aware of any work that's been undertaken in the departments to address this?
I'm not actually aware of anything at the moment. I think previously there was consideration that maybe a report could be written which might identify these, but as far as I'm aware at the moment, I don't think that's happened. But I can certainly ask Michelle and get back to you, Annette. That's...
I'd really appreciate that. I suppose I was thinking, how far under the 50,000 did they start? How far over did they go? Are we anticipating that we're going to get more of this as it goes on, or less? And it's just to see, obviously there's an issue there with the system. Is it the Integra system? Because that's unable to provide the report. But is there any work being done on this? That would be great. Thank you.
That's fine. I'll look into that and I'll get back to you.
Thanks.
Margaret, see you for your hand up.
Yes, a couple of points on that one. As part of the Integra system development, when we brought it in at first, all we were doing was bringing in a very basic system. We've adopted all the standard features that Capita offered us, and we've then progressively refined it. We're on to release 5 in terms of our internal work to tweak and develop that system to make it more ERC. And we're currently working through a wish list of things that we want to address in release 6. Now, I don't know the exact details. I don't want to give you 100% guarantee, but I do know that on that release 6, part of the work plan, I think about 20 days is devoted to improving reports, including audit reports. Now, I'm not certain whether this is one of the particular ones that's been picked up, but I know that procurement and audit reports were listed as one of the areas to be looked at in Area 6, in Release 6. The other thing to mention is that just because there is no certification by procurement where it goes over 50,000 does not mean that someone senior has not looked at it. One of the benefits of the Integra system is that we've brought in one of the earlier releases, we've brought in a sort of graded system of the level of authority that is required before you can place a new order. So up to a certain staffing grade, people would have authority to authorise low-level orders, and more expensive orders require a senior management sign-off. And anything that is 50,000 or above, in addition to the senior manager in the service authorising it, it must also be authorised by procurement. So it's not as if there are no controls, it's just that we have a sort of step ladder of controls, if you like. And just at that, transferring over the trigger point into the top one is where something can sometimes change. And say you've got 28 cases there. I couldn't tell you how close to the 50,000 they were, but you know, it's just to give you assurances that there are different controls. And in fact, it's probably a more uniform set of controls than we've ever had before.
Thanks so much, Margaret.
Well done. Thanks, Margaret. I mean, I have some sympathy for what Annette is saying, because we both sit in the Planning Applications Committee, and we know that for a major application, anything over 50 houses, and we get all these applications coming in for 49 houses, and then a second one for 49, and you think somebody's just at it. So I can understand where Annette's coming from in that one. Any further questions for Fiona or Margaret or anybody else for that matter? Linda?
It was just to remind the committee that there'll be a report prepared on this on behalf of the committee for submission to the next full council meeting in October.
Thank you. Any further comments or questions? And if not, then I hope to see most of the councillors at the next meeting in an hour and 3 minutes. And can I also say thank you very much to all our guests who have joined us today, and especially to Emma Rose, and I hope you haven't put her off for the next time. Thanks very much, everybody. And we'll see you next time, the 25th of November.